Hi everybody. Today I wanted to discuss Fidelity, and they are an investment company located here in Boston. I just wanted to start by looking at what it would be like if you worked at Fidelity. And just as a disclaimer, I do invest with Fidelity. However, I'm not perfectly happy with everything with them. Just wanted to do some research. I thought I discovered that they had somewhere between $3 and $8 trillion worth of investments, and it was even hard for me to understand. Okay, so are these what's going on here? So there's just data that didn't make sense and things that didn't make sense for me personally about the company, and I just wanted to find out more. I'd known that they've been around for a while, there was certain things I like about them, certain things I don't like about them, and here they are in Boston. So if you're familiar with the East Coast here, let me pause this for a second. So I just added a little bit of a black marble and a population. So if you're not familiar with population distribution maps for the entire Earth on Google with their Earth here, this is really awesome to see. So you can kind of see the population. In general, there's quite a lot of people right here. Quite a lot of people in Chicago and other areas. It just never has felt, it just feels very different. I grew up in Chicago area, certainly the East Coast just is a lot different. There's a lot more nooks and crannies and interesting areas, and certainly that's what make New York City special. I'm gonna turn off this map here, and you can kind of see. So we're kind of zooming in here on Fidelity. So a lot of the investment companies are in New York, and don't quote me on that, but just that's my kind of feeling. And Fidelity here, being one of the largest in the world, is located right here. Now they're not just one of the largest in the world. From what I've seen, it's a significant percentage. So in terms of the global stocks that are traded every day, Fidelity might even trade, I don't know, I just as a quick estimate, maybe 5% of those. How I got that number, well, I did some homework and math on that, but you can do your own math and figure out what you think. So it's probably slightly less than 5%, but in general, that's an easy number to remember. So, but here you go. You can kind of see Fidelity here. Now, I'm gonna quickly zoom in because there's a lot of stuff going on. Now, you can see Providence down here. Actually, it's a really great place. I would say it's comparable. It's got a lot of nooks and crannies like New York as well. But Boston, the nice thing about being headquartered in Boston is it's one of the original places where America was founded, and there's a lot of great universities there, like MIT and Harvard. You can kind of start to see what's going on here. If you ever landed in Boston, my parents live out on Cape Cod, and but this is the airport here. It's just a huge airport relative to the size of the cities. You can see it's kind of funny. It just looks so amazing landing in Boston. This does not capture what's going on, but these little islands are just so interesting. I learned how to sail, just small, cheap little sailboats out on Cape Cod area. But you start to see Boston coming in here, and this actually looks pretty realistic to me. Just not a whole lot of huge buildings in Boston, and kind of a lot of suburbs, and just an interesting river kind of cruising on through here. But Fidelity, so I'm not super familiar with Boston, but out in here is, like, say, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, and this is Cambridge, and so on. So the nice part about MIT is it's fairly a lot closer to downtown, and a lot of the companies have kind of headquartered in here, including like Google and some other ones. Right here, kind of around Kendall Square, and it might even show you that MIT, 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 and then this is called East Cambridge. But in general, so like downtown is quite a bit a ways from this whole academic area, and it's kind of nice, but it's actually it feels a little bit ghetto as you get out towards Cambridge, to be honest. Harvard kind of struggled with that, I'd imagine, but it gives it maybe this very rich students. Reality check. But there's this whole area here. So basically, I'm not an expert with Boston, but there's a park here. It's a very lonely park and not a whole lot of activity there. So basically, there's another school out in this area as well, and then Fidelity in here. So I'm just kind of putting context. Now this area is a very mysterious area because you can see there's almost no large buildings here. I think there's like a Paul Revere house. Might even show where that house is, but it's just kind of funny because there's just no. It's kind of a scary neighborhood, to be honest. It's nice that they've kept it this way, and that's really because they just haven't had a lot of really good quality architects come in here because they're constantly battling between kind of like the old school style Cape Cod house with these modern buildings that are just horrendous. But the interesting thing about Fidelity here is that they have chosen kind of a kind of lower level building here, not one of these maybe, but and then also close to the waterfront here and kind of along this area. And this whole area has just really, this is the convention center, I believe. I've been to a tech discussion there before and it was interesting. Well, it wasn't interesting, but I did see the first Geiger counter I've ever seen. But anyway, they have a couple bridges here, and this whole area is just really great for new development, but it's kind of being trashed. The way that they're developing it is, I don't know, it seems terrible. But primarily with Fidelity here, we're going to get into a street view and kind of see what it might look like to be here. It's kind of still loading, but I'll kind of zoom in and move around so you can see what this all looks like here at Fidelity headquarters. So you can imagine there's a nice little train coming in here, and I think this is even the Greyhound station. Yeah, so that's really close to the Greyhound station, and this is a great thing because easy way to get in and out of the city, and actually this whole highway is the one that I usually take in. So this is a really fast location in general. You know, if you're even on this side of the city near the city center and I guess the capital of area, it's, or the state, it's just tough. It's just, I don't know, I don't like fighting traffic, so this would just be really quick and nice, imagining that kind of, again, you can kind of see there's a few really kind of what I would say sacred buildings here in Boston. I'm not sure, love to point those out. They feel very mysterious, but you can kind of see that this whole vast parking lot. And it's still kind of loading up the imagery here. Sorry about that. But and you can kind of see this park area here. So I would say I don't know that a whole. I'm not like an, I haven't lived in downtown Boston. I've lived in San Francisco and New York and Cape Cod. It is a very different city than say like Chicago and these other places. Just because it has this old school feel to it. I'm kind of just looking for this transition point between this North End and what they call the financial district or downtown. It's just interesting here. So I'm going to pause this and try to do a street view in a second here. Okay. So here I am going to drop in a street view, and it looks like the best I can do is right. I'm going to try to do it on this side just because it's nice to see the waterfront. If we can get this, we'll see. Heeks doesn't do it. So sometimes you can't get the best street views on these. So you gotta kind of choose. Wanted to get the waterfront there, but let's see if we can get this point right about here. That looks like a place that I might check out. So here we are at Fidelity, kind of the, you know, if I got stressed out at work, I might just take a walk along the riverfront here, which is kind of a nice thing. The rivers are really great. I never felt that way in New York. Just there's so much fastness, but there's just so much stuff going on in downtown that it's just, you almost forget about the rivers. But Boston's not that way at all. The rivers are kind of nicer, actually, for some reason. Maybe in part it's because of the Hudson River in New York just being. So here we go. So no signage, interestingly, on the building. So don't even tell me if this is not the building. I just looked it up on the internet. It was actually kind of hard to find the headquarters. But certainly it just had this address right here, 245 Summer Street. So interestingly, I know other Fidelity buildings definitely do have the label there on the side of the building, and that's fine. Actually, I don't like having lots of labels, and it's still kind of loading in this imagery. Sorry about this. So we're going to go to the end of the block here and see what else we can see. So it's just kind of slow loading. Sorry about that. But you can basically kind of see. Now, the scary part about this is just the amount of wealth in this one building. So, and if they have that much wealth, there's probably side projects, guys. So you can kind of see some other buildings here, and then the Fidelity building kind of back in here. I just like these old traditional buildings a little bit better, and I wanted to kind of see. So I can't really say. It says the station. So maybe that's even the part of the bus station that we were looking at before. So in general, this is the feel. So if you kind of look at this feeling here, you're starting to get this like chaotic feeling where heading back in here, these lower level buildings might be pretty older, and then these newer buildings. It's kind of a, this is like the tragedy of modern life, is that Fidelity really just showed up recently. So, and look at this. So this is an interesting surprise. So we see on the side of this building, it says Federal Reserve Bank. So that would be interesting. So maybe Fidelity being super close to the Federal Reserve, that's kind of a nice little thing that we discovered here. So basically the Federal Reserve is there. We might be able to even find out some more things. What I would do is I'm going to zoom out here a little bit. So this building is the Federal Reserve. And if we add places, I think I can do not that. There's one other one. More, yeah. So under more, you can add place categories. So yeah, so this will add all of their categories, and it might take a little while to load that in. I like the Wikipedia ones because you can see Federal Reserve, South Station, One Financial Center, Square, and then Russia Wharf. And so different things. So unfortunately, it's just starting to load in the labels here. It takes a little while. So, but if we zoom out, you can probably start to see where these labels are. So you can start to see all these little labels coming in, and looks like even a little bit of a research library there. So that's interesting to find out about. And post office, United States Postal Inspection, Boston Children's Museum, and a couple little cafes, Dunkin' Donuts. So actually, the food is kind of over on this street, right? So if you were to get lunch, hang out with the Fidelity guys, it'd probably be right along here, but actually preferred even just taking a little stroll. People need exercise. These guys probably spend too much time like you and me in front of computers. So, you know, there's a couple other things here. So this is Dunkin' Donuts and maybe some Metro Cafe. So, and then maybe a couple other things. So it's, as I said, there's this whole new area kind of on the, this area that's kind of starting to pop up. And I've actually kind of hung out a little bit. I think I've even gotten, took a stroll after leaving here. I think I went over on this street or something. But there's a whole, the nice thing to see is these little docks and boat yards. And that's really what makes Boston. And that was really the life in 1800s, was sailing and getting around that way. And even 1400s and so on. But here we are in modern times with Fidelity. So in general, you can kind of see there's so, in Boston, if you're not familiar, there's a lot of biotechnology, and a lot of that is, I think the Harvard, there's Boston Public Library here, and College of Music, and Symphony Orchestra. But yeah, back in here, there's a whole lot of other kind of, and biotechnology is kind of a big thing here, so it's interesting to think about how Fidelity would fit in with the rest of the town. And certainly as you zoom out here, we'll just zoom out and kind of see. So it's hard. Like Boston, suburban Boston is not good. So I'm not a big believer in commuting or anything. So if you live and work in the area, that's pretty much your only choice. It's not good as you get further and further out. It's just really nice to have the fresh breeze of the ocean coming in. And even out here in Boston or Cape Cod area where my parents live, kind of a nice little island area. And then you can see out here even to New York City. So this makes it look pretty close. But if you zoom out like this, you can kind of see mileage. So this is, I would say it's like, it's a good 2 hours just for this. Okay, fine. Hour and a half, hour and 15. But 2 hours, I don't like to. I hate traffic. So if this is two, and you're talking 2 hours to here, it's 4 hours, and including getting all in the car, out of the car, maybe 5 hours to New York. So don't even quote me on that. So just do the mileage yourself. So this is like 1 hour, 2 hours, three, four, five, I don't know, and then the traffic could be 3 hours just from here to here. So give yourself 8 hours just to get to New York with the traffic in Boston and everything. But basically, that is Fidelity's headquarters. So, and just to put it into perspective with New York City and kind of the rest of the world, I think it's important to look at this because Fidelity's working on trillions of dollars, perhaps even 5% of the. Well, it'd be like something like a little bit less than five. It'd be maybe 1 or 2% of the global. Seems like a small number, but actually it's probably 5%. I don't know. Anyway, so it's huge number, 8 trillion. If the whole global stock market is 90 trillion, 8 trillion is approximately 10%. So from that perspective, if the numbers are correct of 90 trillion, then and if Fidelity is saying that they have 8 trillion, then that gives you the number. But so surprisingly close here to like Europe, right? A lot of flights coming in and out of Europe. Even when you compare here, kind of Northern Africa and Spain and some other areas, and then basically the whole rest of the West Coast, so and Latin America and so on. So, anyway. Okay, so here is the Wikipedia page for Fidelity, and I've been looking at a couple that you can see. I have a lot of tabs open. I'm looking at a lot of different comparing these, and I just like to see a really well done Wikipedia page with lots of facts and truth. It's kind of hard to read. It's just I think a lot of people are kind of I don't know. It's Wikipedia, but. In here, you can see the basic numbers, and I'll just show you kind of the problem here, right? So, this says assets under management 3.3 trillion, but on Fidelity's page, this is discretionary assets. So, there's a difference between assets under management, and I think they made a mistake here. So, this says assets under management 8.3 trillion. So, and this number is even wrong compared to what it says on their page. So, this says 8.8 trillion. So there's a lot of money here. You can see they have about 20, what is this? So 32 million individual investors and some brokerage accounts. So not totally familiar with what that means, but 2.2 million trades per day. So quite a lot. This is just on their about page. Didn't even load these images properly, but this is also interesting here, and this is so 75 million total customer accounts. That's probably the sum of both of those. And I'm doing a lot of employee benefits, and that's kind of how I get started with Fidelity. But and I thought it was kind of a little bit strange because this company looks to be run by the daughter of the original guy. So this guy died in 1984, and his can see here, this is him and then his daughter. So, could be good, could be bad. But you can kind of see some of the history here. And this is saying to a record 3.2 trillion. So, I don't know what these numbers are meaning. So, these numbers are ginormous, right? So, also, I would look at this revenue and operating income. So, this is interesting to think about. So you basically have, so of this, let's say if it was 3.3 trillion, you know, so you're basically talking about several decimal places back, right? So this would be 10th, that would be so right there. So, so you know, basically, if you let me just do this on my calculator here. So we got 3, 3, and then 0, 0. And if you just divide that by the revenue, 18.2, and we do 1 over that to flip it. So basically, they're making about 1%, 0.5% on the money, which turns out to be $18.2 billion. And that's a lot of money, but that kind of gives you the perspective. So if you have 3.3 trillion that you're managing, you might make 1% or a half of a percent on that. And that's essentially that, but that is still accounts for a huge amount of money. And if you take the number for the people, so let's just say 50,000 people. So this is dollars per employee. So you have 18,200, and that would be billion, and a couple more zeros, that'd be million, and I want to add 3 more zeros here, and so 18, if I do 18 billion, I'm just checking this and dividing it by 50,000, we get about $300,000 worth of so basically each employee is bringing in about it's $350,000. So each employee is bringing in about that much money, and certainly it might not be proportional, right? So $300,000, that's kind of a lot of money. If you were working at Fidelity, you're either managing quite a lot of money, and we could do that number as well. If you want to figure out how much they're managing, we take 8 trillion divided by 50,000. And we can just, we'll do that on Google really quick. So it's a little faster here. So if you do 8.8 trillion divided by 50,000, and Google will give us the answer really faster than I can type it. If my web search, okay, it's 106 million. So I don't know, that's 76 million. So each employee is managing $176 million. Wow. Okay, so am I even calculating that right? Is that does that make sense? So it's $100 million per person. So I just don't know what to say about a number like that. So I mean that's the number right there, right? So each employee, I mean, they don't talk about this on their webpage, but you're managing, if you work for Fidelity, $100 million is essentially what, like, the shape of, like, how much influence you could potentially, you got to be very careful, right? So that's huge, right? And I'm just not even sure. So, you know, for $100 million, you basically, you know, it's the profit on that is $350,000, right? That's what we just calculated, right? So to kind of put this all in perspective, I mean, it's taking my breath away to think about these numbers. And for that matter, you know, if the average, you know, there's 300 million or so people in America, you know, and each employee, you know, it's just huge. It's a huge amount of money. So that's why I wanted to discuss this. So in general, there's a lot of other details here. I wanted to kind of dive into the actual website. So this looks like Fidelity Investments Investor Center in Boston. So this might be a nicer building rather than the one we were looking at. Even here, I noticed they said that was kind of their thing. So on this map, you can kind of see just a branches overview page, all their locations. So pretty heavy in this area. And we probably even want to zoom in. Sorry, it's kind of not such a great map, but think Fidelity and their multimillionaires trying to work on making the web page look this great. They're not really trying to be found, apparently. But a couple shops here, and then in Chicago, I'm familiar with as well. And I think I have this page. So this is kind of their mutual fund search page, and or their ETFs too. Basically, I already kind of sorted this. I do not like the way they do this. You have to click on these other ones, income character, and I just wanted to see volume, like how much, what's the volume of these, and some other. They don't even list the price for these, so they list the risk, their calculated risk. Let me see. This is Fidelity Funds only. So if you go back to this page, this will kind of give you, so you can select no transactions. And so I'm not sure about this number, but okay, so like BlackRock Investment controls about 800 different ETFs only. So they might have a whole ton of mutual funds as well. And I'm not sure if the mutual funds are part of the ETFs now, but from what I understood, so Fidelity, it looks like if you do Fidelity Funds only, you can see they have about 315 total. And so this would be like a search for all of them. And then if there's no transaction fees, you can kind of see a percentage. So roughly a third of them have no transaction fee. And that may be just when you buy or sell the stock. I'm not even familiar with that because I do not work with these kinds of investment. I have a Fidelity account, but I try to just think about things as much as I can and not pay for these investment funds, which I'm probably wrong about sometimes. But so they do have this minimum investment and then management's approach, all active and index. So if you wanted to look at the Fidelity only ones, we can look at that. I'm not going to do that first. So I'm going to just, they don't even let you do no transaction. So let's do no transaction fee. That was actually their default. We might even be able to do this alternative. So they got different types of search and then risk. God. Okay. So let's just keep it simple with no transaction. Keep this as in general as possible. So what I was really hoping to get here is the volume, and I may have to just grab the downloaded results here, and I'm going to see if I can download all 300 of those, and I'll get back to you on that in a second. But if this actually did download all 300, I can put this into Google Sheets and then grab the data live, and that may actually be better. So it's going to try to load this up, and got some kind of input error on the file here. Ooh, sorry about that. It worked and then dropped. So let me pause this for a second. Okay, so this is one of the problems here. So basically, I sorted this by 10-year return. So these are their very, very best ones by percentage return. And you can see technology, healthcare, and then large growth, mid-cap growth, and large growth. And actually, the lifetime of these has actually been about 16, 12, 13%. So, and I'm not even sure what that means. I guess if that's your original investment, gives you only 13% gain, and that's hard for me to believe. So and then I guess they got this buy ticker here, pretty funny. If they have these income characteristics, I'm just gonna try to see if they have any other details here. So they do have minimum investments that they list here, and their dividend. It looks like you can sort this by dividend and short-term performance, daily prices, and yields. So maybe this is what, so this NAV is kind of the, especially when you put your money into one of these, they recalculate it, and the price is based on all the shares out there. So it's the total value of the investments divided by the number of shares that they are offering. So that's how they do this. And basically, you know, it's just, I'm not even sure what to say about this. I don't like the way that they've done this. I mean, I was looking for other things. Now, these risk beta, these are maybe some more 3-year shape ratio and standard deviation. So essentially, the NAV may be helpful, because, but the problem is they may issue more shares and things like that to make it easier for people to invest in. So pulling your money in or out could be interesting. I actually don't like even researching this anymore. So it just seems like, in general, they have a tremendous amount of money invested. So a lot of people are putting their money into these, and hopefully they've put their money into some of these better ones. So you can just see that software, semiconductors, have done slightly worse than software over the long term, but then recently, for the last 10 years, semiconductors have done better, and then biotechnology. And actually, the bigger win is kind of on, I don't know, these guys. So, and this is Morgan Stanley. So, I thought I did Fidelity only once, but for some reason, I don't even know if they're, wait, we just did this on no fee or low fee. So, you know, life of the fund could be more interesting statistic. And you can kind of see here this guy doing fairly well. But in general, most of these, it's kind of just decreasing as we go down here, just sorted by the 10 years. So I'm not too interested in these. It's just astounding to me how much money is being put into these investments. You know, let's just look at one of the better ones, like the semiconductor one. See what they have to say. Gonna take a little bit to load here. So you can kind of see this is their page, and I don't know if this will be accessible to you. I have an account, didn't require my login for this apparently, so maybe it will be available. You know, it's just I have used their Fidelity software, and man, they should get this all. Like, that you have to download this, and it won't even work on my Linux system. So I have to use my Macintosh, and it's unbelievably slow, their software. I think it's almost got a virus, you'd say, and it's just terrible. But I still invest with them sometimes, just because I like to see a different one rather than the other trading platform I'm using. But yeah, at least a simple graph here to kind of get us looking at this. And this is the fund right here, the purple one, and shows that it's doing quite a bit better than these others, which we already would expect because that was their top one. So you can see their portfolio as well. So I actually don't like to do this kind of stuff on Fidelity. I don't even trust. I don't even trust it. So let me pause this and I'll show you another way that you can kind of look at the same data. Okay, so here is the other way that you might want to do this. And I would also use TradingView too, but I like Yahoo because it's... TradingView just seems tough. They want to try to charge you for everything. But so here we go. So I typed in this symbol for this Fidelity Select Semiconductor Portfolio. And the interesting thing is you can look at holdings, so the chart, and sometimes, so it shows like 99% technology. And here it shows, so I just wanted to compare this with what Fidelity's page was showing. So we can see, so I think this was Fidelity's, and here they show, so it's another example, like, so Fidelity says, these are their top holdings. Doesn't show the percentages. Maybe it's because of liability reasons they're afraid, but honestly, it's worse. So you can see they own 23% of NVIDIA. And then Qualcomm. So let's just look at Qualcomm. So Qualcomm number two. So another example of why it might. So Fidelity, I feel like you're falling apart here, guys. Like you gotta show some details. If Yahoo doesn't even do what you do and makes far less money and they are more useful, so what's wrong with you guys? And then Intel and the rest. So you might even want to grab this. And the problem with Yahoo is, well, what's all the rest? So you might actually have to get it from Fidelity. And if we click more, maybe there's more detail here. So this gets us a little more detail. But again, I wanted to see precise percentages. The difference between this and like an ETF, which is kind of nice, is that like Nvidia is not the biggest technology company in the world. Neither is Microchip and these other guys. So it kind of is more selective. They choose based on what they think. And sometimes if I agree or don't agree, kind of agree Nvidia is good. But honestly, Nvidia is pretty high right now. So maybe this is a sticky, difficult investment, right? Like when they put a lot of their money, like Intel might be a little bit lower now relative to Nvidia's PE ratio, for example. And you see, they have only a little bit of an investment in Taiwan, which is a pretty big mistake because honestly, if as a side fact, I know that 40, like 50% of all the semiconductors in the world come from Taiwan, and yet this is a semiconductor fund that only has 1.73% invested in Taiwan. What are you guys thinking? But part of that could be from strategic reasons. So, for example, if they're invested in American companies, they can kind of depend on the American government to help them out if there is a legal dispute, or when you're investing billions of dollars, you can't make a mistake. So that may be one of the problems here, right? So when you're a personal investor, you're not dealing with billions of dollars, so you can maybe invest directly in Taiwan Semiconductor, for instance. But I think Taiwan Semiconductor is too high, so I wouldn't have invested in them anyway. But you can see here, so semiconductor equipment. So I'd say, hey, why are you so low in semiconductor in equipment? I mean, this is semiconductors, but they're not. So they don't really believe in semiconductors, I would say, in some ways. Anyway, so the whole market is very biased towards maybe sales. And I just don't like this page at all. So I far prefer Yahoo's page. And even if you go to the summary, the graphs are just terrible here. I mean, I can't get what I'm going to get. So if you go back to Yahoo's page, you can also check. So on the chart, let me just show you a quick little chart. It just looks way better. And if I do a full screen, you can see why. Ooh, geez. I have so much other stuff on here. I'm sorry about this. These are some other things I was comparing, and I'm really sorry about this. But in general, you can get a lot of data on Yahoo. So I'm gonna just go back to Fidelity, and we'll have to look at the charts some other time. But in general, this is the Fidelity page. So I feel like, God, it looks nice and clean, but it's just, I don't know, not my style. So here you can see some other one. And I think they also show, they usually show who. Okay, so yeah, institutional and other institutional investors don't invest in these. So on a typical stock, you can look at who's the funds that are invested in. So for example, INTC is Intel, and they are a semiconductor company. And we can see under here, you can see click on holders, and that will take us to the holder. So actually, Vanguard is the biggest holder at Intel, and you don't even really see Fidelity on these guys. So, to me, that's a question here, right? So, who's making your breaker processor? Okay, well, Fidelity's invested in semiconductors, but they're not invested in Intel. But then again, they didn't make. I don't like the CEO of Intel. He's got some problems. He seems all right, but it's they need a really good technology person, kind of like Nvidia. Or excuse me, AMD's got their act together now, and they're doing a lot better because they but these are the companies, and you can kind of see an astounding amount of percentage is held by institutions. So two out of every three stocks are owned by an institution and not by private investor. And insiders only own a very small percentage of Intel, which is shameful that this is the way that the world is. But in general, this is the deal for Fidelity, right? So, I mean, I'm not sure what to say. I mean, you could try to use this thing to search. It's, to be honest, Yahoo has a terrible screener for mutual funds. It's okay, but you can't search for details that you'd want to see. So, and as I don't know, I'm just really frustrated with these mutual funds in general. So this shows 9,829. So let's just check Yahoo really quick. So on a Yahoo screener, they have ETF screeners. And I tried this out the other day, and there's mutual fund screener, ETF. And this is another bug with Yahoo. So you have to take, so if you add these rating ones, and it's still trying to search for them, I think you have to take out certain, I don't know, let's see if we can find this. Only finds two. Yeah, so this is one of the bugs. I don't know if I'm, I've tried to add NASDAQ. Let's just add everything on this. And that finds 4,000. So, and if I add the last star, see what that finds. Sometimes it even crashes on me. So this finds 4,650. And this is the problem, right? So I want to sort it by volume because I want to see where what people are trading. But I kind of want to look at the price and the volume. So in general, I want to see where the most valuable mutual funds, where people are trading in general. What the, I can sort this by volume. That's good. Maybe they changed it on me here. So the all right. So this, and then the problem now becomes they have these Taiwan mixed in here. So I'm not even sure, is this like only a Taiwan mutual fund? Might be able to remove that somehow with doing American only, but Invesco, so this one is ETF, right? So we know that's perhaps one of the world's most traded ETFs, and you don't really see, and we can just search for Fidelity on this, and they don't show up. So basically, theirs are not really traded a lot, and so I just don't know, like when you do a search like this, okay, so like Fidelity, but this is this mutual fund, so yeah. So I mean, is there another search that they have for ETFs? Maybe. Not even really willing to Fidelity mutual funds. So I mean, investment products, I can't click on that, so I'd have to go all the way back there. So I don't know, like Fidelity, at least from the data I've seen, I don't think they're a big player in ETFs. So maybe their mutual funds is just about everything. So why they're not doing ETFs, who knows? These managed funds, I mean, they're managing a huge amount of money. So they're not even listed on these guys. So it might be interesting to see what is the percentage of, what is the percent of ETFs versus mutual funds. I don't know. It's just garbage. So, so you kind of got to do it yourself. So anyway, so basically this is the volume. That's perhaps the best way to do this. Price, I mean, you don't know because it could be number of shares outstanding. So they just didn't, there's not any way to list this really. You know, in general, you would check. Having a high volume is a sign of good things, so that's what I trust. And honestly, yeah, so you can see a lot of iShares in here. So, and I'm not sure why. Now the screener, do they have mutual fund screener? Maybe this will show us all this. So, I mean, if I do 9,000 here, well, this, okay, it comes up with even more. So the Fidelity screener shows something like 9,000. This shows 15,000. So, well, is this because of some kind of thing, a rating system? I don't know. So if you do the rating system here, and this is only NASDAQ, I'm not sure why. This is another problem with the New York Stock Exchange. I just don't trust the New York Stock Exchange because it's so hard to list on the New York Stock Exchange. So what's really going on here? Is there any mutual funds on the New York Stock Exchange? I mean, it didn't look like it changed the numbers. So, I mean, there's a lot for me to learn here, but why would the New York Stock Exchange, they just list companies, and the NASDAQ has allowed these guys. And in some ways, it's bad. Like, I can understand why the New York Stock Exchange would say, hey, man, we're just trying to do stocks. If you guys are just going to leech off the stock market and build mutual funds and then take all the profits away from people anyway, what's the deal? And certainly a lot of people hate that kind of stuff. And but anyway, so from this data, you'd have to say there's maybe more mutual funds than quite a bit more, right? So we'd have to look at that number again. In general, that's kind of the deal here. So Yahoo, this is a pretty good screener. TradingView also has a screener, and I haven't really even tried it for mutual funds before, but you can kind of see here what's going on. So, I mean, does this even work for mutual funds? I don't know. So I think I have this saved. Does it save it? That's the name of that semiconductor one that we checking. Doesn't even show up. So maybe they don't do mutual funds on this. So you got to use Yahoo. So I'd have to look at this. Don't quote me on that. This looks like mostly stocks. So, but going back to the Fidelity one, in general, fun pick. So do they pick ones outside of Fidelity? Maybe they do 315, right? So, okay. So, but anyway, let me know what you think. Fidelity, you know, I mean, they're okay. There's some details on the inside that I could probably talk about that are great. Like when you do a trade, they allow you to do conditional orders a little bit more specific than some of the other companies, which is great, but actually less specific than if you had like an actual tool. So it's just nice to be able to do it from the web and some other things. Hope this has helped. It's been a little bit frustrating, to be honest, just to look at this because I'm not really that interested in mutual funds or ETFs. But in general, at least it helps both of us get an idea of what's going on.